Thank you so much. So, Dan gave me the task of talking about leading out of your marriage as a sign and a wonder. And it really is very appropriate for a topic for tonight. So, if you do have your notes, which I suspect some of you may not, we're on page 12. If you have it, that would be great. We're on page 12. And so, all right, so I'm not going to, how many of you are single here? Raise your hands. All right, good. All right. We love you singles. We want you to know that Jesus and Paul were single. And there's a whole theology of singleness that we're not going to go into tonight, all right? But it is critical that we treat singles and marrieds equally, as equally important in the body of Christ. And we need singles and singles need marrieds. But tonight we're just going to focus on marriage in particular and as a sign and a wonder. So, So again, we've been, you know, many of you read the Emotionally Leader book before you came, and kind of were framing at least our major sessions here on some of the content in that book and really applying it. And so remember the themes. You have an inner life, four core pilings or steel beams in our inner lives that inform our outer lives of leadership. And so face your shadow was number one, and we touched on that this morning. We did a genogram, and how important that is that we look at the things from our past that are holding us back. We don't go back for morbid introspection. We go back only to break the power of things that are holding us back from going forward. And then a second is lead out of your marriage and singleness. Now, so singleness is part of that, but we're not going to go there tonight. But isn't it, I want you to know, it's very intentional that this is the second piling. That's how important this is in terms of long-range, sustainable mission and healthy churches, you know, for the glory of God. So that's our thrust tonight, and because it impacts everything, planning, decision-making, culture, team building, power, boundaries, endings, beginnings, everything's informed by how we understand our marriages and, of course, our singleness as well. So there's three words I want you to hang your hat on for the next half hour. Ambition, passion, and sign and wonder. Okay, you ready with me, everybody together? Ready? Ambition, passion, sign and wonder. If you remember nothing else, remember those words, those three words. All right, so the first is that if you're married, if you made a vow of marriage, marriage is to be your first ambition. Now, my first 8 years of marriage, I had a very compartmentalized, unbalanced theology of marriage and leadership. Theology was basically, you know, fulfill the Great Commission in the world, seek first the kingdom of God, and everything else will be added onto you, including a great marriage. It'll just happen. It'll flow. God will take care of it. And, you know, you marry someone to double your ministry type of thing. And marriage is important, but it's not central. It's kind of like on the side. You know, it's spiritual, but it's not as spiritual as other things, like, you know, the Word and prayer and worship and the Word and preaching. That's really spiritual. Sex and intimacy and connection and marriage, it's kind of like, you know, secondarily important. And that was kind of my marriage. So my wife and I, our first 7-8 years of our marriage, we were stable, but we were unhappy. We were stably unhappy. And, but we were used to it. It was like, you know, serving Christ and church planting and all that. And we were committed to each other. We loved each other. And we were friends for 8 years before we fell in love, you know, and got married. So we had a really a deep friendship. And then we fell madly in love. And we were very committed. Then we hit this wall in our marriage and a wall in our leadership. And in 1996, we had a second conversion that we call emotionally healthy spirituality. But it really, God met us in our, it was really in our marriage this whole thing was birthed. God met us in our marriage. And I've been to many meetings where the Holy Spirit has fallen in great power. Right? I mean, over the years, I'm sure many of you have as well, where the Spirit of God just in a room of such power that you feel like, oh my gosh, you know, heaven's down. I have visited the floor more than a few times in my life, and I'm not a floor guy. I don't go down easily, you know. But I've been knocked down by the Holy Spirit, you know. And I really have been in some incredible meetings. But none of them have been as significant and great as the experience of the glory of God that I've experienced in my marriage. And we had a taste of something. It was 1996 that I didn't have words for, and she didn't have words for, but we knew it was the glory of God in our marriage. And we had a little theology to understand what had happened. And we have spent the last 20 years growing in it and exploring it theologically. And it was really, it was like a conversion. I was blind, but now I see. And it really was a revelation. And I really hope today you're going to hear some things very differently. I pray that you receive a revelation tonight, a revelation that will actually change your life, whether you're single or married in this room. It'll so impact you that you will do leadership differently from this day forward. And so, again, we're still learning. We're always learning and growing. But those three words, ambition, passion, and sign and wonder kind of summarize it. And so the first is you make marriage your first ambition. Now think about ambition for me. Ambition is not a bad word. It's a neutral word. It depends on which direction it goes in. You know, ambition is a strong desire. You want to achieve something. You know, so you think of things like, you know, I got an ambition, you know, to build a big church, you know, or big ministry to reach, you know, millennials for Christ or next generation or youth. You know, I want to, you know, that's a good thing. You know, other people have ambition, you know, to dream big dreams and do something that's not been done before. And others... It's my daughter, excuse me. Kids are always first, right? So some people have ambition to make a lot of money, right? And some that have the best church in the denomination. And we're encouraged in leadership conferences to dream big, right? Big dreams for God. But, you know, obviously our first ambition is God, right? I mean, he is our first ambition. Seek his face, Psalm 27:4. But if you're married, after your commitment to Jesus and him being your first ambition, our first ambition, if we are married, is our spouse, not our churches. And so I am a Christian leader and I'm married. That's what most people say. I'm a Christian leader. I'm a Christian pastor and missionary, and I'm married. It's very different than saying, as a Christian leader, I lead out of my marriage. I want you to catch the difference. They're very different statements. As a Christian leader, I lead out of my marriage. That's what we're talking about here tonight. See, the Bible, there's such a thing called a marital spirituality in the Bible. And a marital spirituality is different than a single spirituality. It has certain characteristics to it. And if you're married, you know, think of the Bible from Genesis to Revelation. The Bible begins, God creates the institution of marriage right there at creation, Adam and Eve. And the Bible ends with this incredible marriage, Supper of the Lamb. And this wedding feast that will go on forever and ever. That is the two images. And then right in the middle of those brackets, we've got the Song of Songs, this amazing book on erotic sexual love. And so God loves the world so much that he wants to marry us. And there's many, many analogies of our relationship with God, right? Shepherd, sheep, king, subjects, you know, father, son. But the least inadequate analogy of our relationship to God is marriage. And many theologians have talked about this. And at the end of history, we're going to be married to Christ. And so you've got this great image there of the Bible beginning and ending in marriage. Now, Ephesians 5, 31 and 32 has been said by some theologians as the core text that summarizes Genesis to Revelation. That if you understand Ephesians 5, 31 and 32, you've got the whole Bible. And Paul is talking about husbands and wives in this passage, and you've preached from it. Few have preached from this verse. Because Paul's talking about husbands and wives, and all of a sudden he goes, oh yeah, for this reason a man shall leave his father and mother, be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. He quotes Genesis 2. And he goes, this is a profound mystery. Or the word mystery in Greek is, this is a profound revelation. But I am talking about Christ and the church. Paul can't talk about earthly marriage without talking about Christ's marriage to the church. Because for him, they're so tightly related. And he understands marriage in the context of God's passion to marry the world in Jesus. Earthly marriage was created by God. God creates the God created marriage first thing. If he creates the universe and creates the world and creates humanity. Because marriage is supposed to be a pointer and a visible picture of our eternal destiny to be married to God in Christ. It's a visible picture of something much greater than simply a man and a woman falling in love and having a great life together and producing children. It is meant to be a prophetic sign, a picture. It points to our existence, which is, think of union with God. We're in union with our spouses, and we are called to be in loving union with God. That's our future. And so our ambition as we leave our father and mother is to be one flesh with our spouse, to live out that union as a pointer. You know, think of Revelation, think of John 17, that whole prayer of Jesus. Father, I pray that just as I am in you and you are in me, I pray they also would be in us. It's all that language of union, and marriage gives a picture and a taste of that union like no other institution on earth. It offers something to the world of the depth of the love of God that is found no place else on earth. And I want you to think with me for a second of a monastic vow. When people make a vow in a monastery, they go through a very long process, 6, 7, 8 years. They go and they're observers, then they become postulants, then they become novices, then they take what's called temporary vows, and then finally, at about 6, 7, 8 years, they do something called solemn vows. They make a vow, poverty and celibacy, and they that they will be a part of this community for the rest of their lives. Stability. They will not leave this community. They change their names. They give away all their resources. And they're from that point forward known as, you know, brother so-and-so or sister so-and-so. But their entire life is informed by that vow they make to a monastery. Every decision they make, every ambition they have is informed by that vow. Now, in the same way, if you are married, you have made a vow, like a monastic vow. And the vow is that from that point forward, every decision you make in your life as a follower of Jesus will be informed by that vow. And that's why if you're in marriage, you can't live like you're single, because you've made a vow to be married, and now your leadership flows out of that marriage. Now, if you say, out of the love of your marriage, out of the union of your marriage, there is to be a cup that overflows to the world. Now, you're saying, I didn't know all that. You're saying, because if you're married, you can't live like you're single. That's what makes married spirituality very different than single spirituality. And so my first ambition, my mission as a married leader in Christ's church is to convince my wife, Jerry, that you're loved and lovable. Do you understand? God loves her. And I'm sent to love her too, to convince her that she's loved and lovable, and to make what's important to her important to me. That's my mission. That's my job description. You know, that's my calling. So I'm to be, think of God's present with us. I'm to be present to my spouse. I'm to love her the way God loves her. And so, you know, for me, it means things like, you know, I wake up, you know, all the men in my family were narcissists, you know, self-absorbed, you know, and the women were helpmates to help me have a happy life. But the Bible's picture of marriage is very different. I'm to be as present to my wife as Jesus is present to her. You know, what would make today a great day for Jerry to ask that question? For me, I'm easily distracted. So for me, to make what's important to her important to me is to be attentive and thoughtful and not be so distracted. Distracted is my middle name. I could just be in a book all day long. And to stop working at a certain point, you know, and get home and be and really be present with her at home and our family. But people who make marriage their first ambition don't just hope it happens. because it doesn't. But they take very clear steps to make it happen and to achieve it. And so we have ministry objectives and ministry ambitions. And I want you to get here that marriage is your first ambition if you're married. And that this is my life work. I mean, I've been at New Life Fellowship Church for 29 years. I mean, I love our church. But it is not my life. It's my life work in a secondary sense. But Jerry is my life work. Because I made a vow to her. To be one with her. So the question I have to ask each day is, what does Jerry need from me today? What? Because God sent me to do it for her. In a sense, I got a PhD in Jerry. And so I marry her every day. I renew my wedding vows each day. I center my life on her. When I think about abiding in Jesus, my life, and I hope yours, is about abiding in Jesus. He is my life. Jesus is life. Right? So I'm abiding and remaining in him all day long, right? Well, in the same way, I'm abiding and remaining in Jerry all day long. I mean, they're connected. My union with Jesus and my union with my wife are connected. So Jerry's not here, and I rarely travel without her. But she's in me. And I'm in her. She's actually speaking tonight. She's doing the EH relationships course at our church, and I'm here. But I know I'm in her, and I'm thinking about her, and she's thinking about me. Because we're one. Do you understand? We're one. I'm one with Jesus. I'm one with her. But I don't separate my time with Jesus and my oneness with him from my oneness with Jerry because we've made a vow that we would lead out of our marriage, that we'd serve Jesus together out of our marriage. So when you get married to someone, you give birth to something that will never exist again. It's something new. It's the two of you. That's one flesh. And there are a lot of workplaces, and some churches too, demand that if you work here, we're your life. Right? This is your life. And we always say as married people, no. Jesus is my life, and my spouse is my life. And church is after that. Let's hear an amen for that. All right. Thank you. I needed that. So it's not getting a big church. That's my first ambition. It's not going up a career ladder. It's not getting my kids in the best schools. My first ambition, and it's got to be nurtured, is my spouse. To have a marriage that's a sign and wonder to Jesus. All right, number two. And out of our marriage overflows love. So I come to you today out of the overflow of my marriage with my wife, Jerry. And I offer you what comes out of us together as a couple. And then number two, we pray for passion. Passion is the second word. Now, you see, a word of love, singles, in the sense, if you think of singles, give a picture of the breadth of the love of Jesus. In the sense of, because they're not yet, some of them, you know, they're not yet in a vow of marriage to love what's one person, they can love a large number of people broadly. But we as marrieds, we give a picture not of the breadth of the love of God, but the depth of the love of God. The depth of God's love, because we focus on just one person in the world that we love above all else. We love the world, but we made a vow to love this one person beyond all others and to be one with them. And our love reflects God's deep love for people, his passionate love. Now think of, because this is the one relationship, this is the only relationship that has a sexual dimension to it, that we're naked together. You understand? There's no... I have lots of relationships. I love a lot of people, but there is nobody with whom I am naked and without shame with there's a sexual dimension to this relationship. That is within the context of marriage. And I do that with one person, Jerry, for all of life. That's very significant. We are naked and without shame with each other. So think of God's love. You know, we have God's love for us. It's a loyal love, a faithful love. And we overemphasize the loyal love of God in marriages, and that's good. You know, I will, you know, again, back to this verse. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother, be united to his wife. The two will become one flesh. This is a profound mission. I'm talking about Christ and the church. How does Jesus love the church? He loves the church not just with a loyal love, but with a passion love, with an eros. Not just a chesed, not just a faithful love. And we emphasize so much about this faithful love of God. You know, I love you because I have to. Yes, you know, and marriage is to make us holy, so we've got to suffer in this thing. Yes. And, I mean, I'm glad God doesn't feel that way about me. Pete, I love you because I have to. I'm God. But you're a disappointment. You're never measuring up. But I love you. What do you need today? You know, I mean, can you imagine? God loves us with that. Think of Luke chapter 15. When God sees the prodigal son who's coming home, the father runs to that son. I mean, he's crazy about the son. He's kissing him, and you know, and the Greek is, he's kissing him, he's wrapping his arms around him. He's crazy about the son. God's crazy about us. Do you understand? He looks at you, he's crazy about you. He loves you with loyal love, absolutely, regardless of your performance, but he's also has an eros for you. He's crazy about you. Delights in you. We are to have passion in our marriages. We are to be the most passionate couples on the earth. Christian couples. Because of the love of Christ in our midst. And so, you know, it's just, you know, all ages. You know, think of Song of Solomon, you know, and when you fall in love, think of when you fall in love. And God put this like elixir in singles, you know, where this sexual desire, this passion, and you fall in love. And it's almost irrational, right? It's like, oh my gosh, this man, this woman, it's like, yeah, oh gosh, oh, there's nothing wrong with him. They're like, perfect. Oh my God, you know, I eat, drink, and sleep. I just like, you know, I'm with him all day. I want to go home. I call him up on the phone. It's like, oh gosh, you know, and you know, think of Song of Songs, how beautiful you are, my darling. Your eyes behind your veil are doves. Your hair is like a flock of goats. Your teeth, your lips, your mouth. You are altogether lovely, my darling. There's no flaw in you. I mean, that's like, oh. Oh, she's got flaws, of course she does, you know, but she's in love, he can't see it. That's passion, that kind of love, and it's like, and then we get married. And then all I see is all the flaws. And the things I thought were cute, I can't stand. And the passion wanes, and we kind of just go into a stability and there's no passion. There's just loyalty. We're committed. We're committed. We're serving Jesus. But there's no fire. God intends that our marriages are meant to have passion throughout the entire life of our marriage. That there's a sexual charge. There's an energy. There's a desire that we nurture it. It's not just meant to die after engagement. Or the first 6 months of marriage. It is meant to be nurtured. And just like God's love for us is passionate always, so we are called to have a passionate marriage. And we offer that as a gift of a sign of the love of God to the world. So singles can look at our marriages and say, that's worth waiting for. I'm not going to sleep around because they have a great sex life. Could you imagine? So no, they don't see that in us, so they go after the world. Fairs and movies and porn, and they're finding it everywhere else. But our calling, friends, right, it's our first ambition, and so we pray for passion. This is a Holy Spirit-energized passion over the decades that is meant to be nurtured and developed. Romance is not an illusion, it's actually a revelation. When you fall in love, it's a revelation of the love of God, and you are meant to nurture that revelation your whole life. I'm married 32 years. I really am crazy about my wife. She is the most beautiful woman in the world to me. There's nobody I want to sleep with besides Jerry Scazzero. Because I nurture it. We nurture it. It's our first ambition. It's not EHS. It's not New Life Fellowship. It's not writing books. I can tell you that. And it's not our children. And I love our children. They know they're second. They know our marriage is first. And our church knows our marriage is first. And then thirdly you got ambition, passion, you got sign and wonder. Now think of signs and wonders. You know, signs and wonder. You know, the blind see, that's a sign and wonder. The lame walk, that's a sign and wonder. You know, dead are raised, that's a sign and wonder. Everything sign and wonders, that they are pointers of the kingdom of heaven. They're heaven coming down to earth. They give people a visible picture of the love of God, the power of God. And they're concrete, visible signs of the kingdom of God on earth, right? When God comes in power and heals someone and delivers someone. Marriage is meant to be a sign and wonder. I want you to catch that. It's to be that miraculous. I'm talking about Christian marriage, not secular marriage. Christian marriage, which is very different than secular marriage. In other words, when people see the love in our marriages because of Jesus, God's intention is as they see a pointer of God's love for the world, which is passionate. which is loyal. And and our marriage love is a concrete, visible, tangible picture of how God loves us. We offer that to the world and to our churches. We image God in the way we function as male and female genders to each other, and we offer that to the people we serve. So your marital love is not about you only. It's for the world. It's public. It's not just private. I'll say it again. Your marriage is not simply private. It's actually public. And that we, in a sense, if you're married, we go out two by two, evangelizing and showing to the world a sign and a wonder of a Christian marriage that points to Jesus. And that when people see our marriages, they see something they see nowhere else. A love of a depth that reflects the love of God for His church. That's got not just loyalty, but it's got passion in it. So you don't just get married in the church, you get married for the church. I want you to catch that. So you're getting married not just in the church, you get married for the church. I mean, this is the first ministry I bring to our church is our marriage. We go together, not that we're holding hands the whole time, but it's for the church. We offer them the love of Jesus out of our marriage because we're one. And so in some ways, you know, you could ask, you know, when you get a person makes a vow at marriage, you can add this to the vow. Will you spend your love for each other on us? The church can say this. Because you're getting married as a sign and wonder. You're critical. And will you allow us to look to you as a living sign of how Jesus loves us? Can we look to you to see a sign of how Jesus loves us? Will you make that vow for the rest of your lives as a couple? We got to say it to every young couple. And train them on a theology of what it means to be a Christian, what it means to be a Christian married. That we're not just saying, don't fight a lot, and I hope you survive, which is secular marriage. We have a whole nother level we're functioning here out of Scripture. You know, the more the little church, which is a couple, becomes a shrine of love, the greater becomes the possibility of love in the whole community. The more devoted our couples are to one another and to us, the more believable the presence of Jesus in our midst become. That, in some ways, the married couples in the church determine the level of love in that church because of body life, because we are in a vow of oneness, a little church, body life. And we are called to go to a depth as a couple that the rest of the church is not, you know, as brothers and sisters and all that. And so we, in a sense, set that level for the whole church. That's why, just so you know, when you get involved in EHS, in this whole journey, it will eventually lead to strong marriage ministries and a strong singles ministry. It has to, because it's connected to it. And so especially for us in leadership, we said it. Now, our culture says put everything else before your marriage. Before you were talking about being in love. Not just you fall in love. No, you're called to live in that love your whole marriage. So that's got to be cultivated. Now, our culture says you've got so much else to do. You don't have time for that. Right, so you put everything else first before it, you know. I got to put my career first, the church first, the family first, the kids first, retirement first, college education first. No, it's for the kids that we put the marriage first. It's for the church we put the marriage first. It's for the world we put the marriage first. It's for the lost we put that marriage first. And the church can see the love that so closely resembles the love of Jesus for the church. So when I look tenderly at Jerry and she looks tenderly at me, do you understand? I see and taste God's love for me. She's God and skinned for me. And when Jerry overlooks my flaws, and I have plenty, and in marriage you see them all, that's the love of God. So our love reveals, it manifests Jesus' love for the church. It's just, you know, whenever there's love, it always has to overflow. It always has to go out. That's God's love as Father, Son, Holy Spirit, that Trinitarian love, it had to go out into the creation of humanity and us in the world. Marriage love is never self-centered. It just has to go somewhere out into the world to be a gift. And so we're not birthing physical children anymore, but we're birthing children the rest of our lives till we die. Spiritual children in Christ as mothers and fathers of the faith. And healthy churches are built on healthy marriages. Say it again, healthy churches are built on healthy marriage. And every time we strengthen a marriage, we are strengthening that church. And so again, I pray for three things. I pray for my first ambition, I pray for passion, and sign of wonder, that we'd be a sign of wonder. And our vision is that every couple at our church will be a living sign and wonder of God's passionate love for the world. That every couple will be a sign and wonder of God's passionate love for the world. Now, they didn't teach me this in seminary or Bible school or leadership conferences. As one famous leader said to me, if you ever preach this, Pete, you would dismantle some of the mega churches. That's a tragedy. So I just gave you a very quick little biblical theology. But this is our greatest gift to our churches, if we are married, is our marriage. Let me just contrast for a second marital sexuality in a standard way, and I'll call it a Christian sexuality. Because marriage, by its very nature, is a sexual, I'll use the word sacrament, making visible something invisible. Just like the Lord's Supper makes something visible, baptism makes something visible, invisible, right? About who God is and death and resurrection, baptism, right? It's so much in baptism, the Lord's Supper. There's so much happening in the Lord's Supper. Wise marriage is, so much is happening there. It's I like to call it sacramental. It makes visible something invisible. But sexuality is the core of marriage. That's what makes it so distinct. I can be brothers and sisters with lots of people, best friends and all that, but we're more than friends. We're more than brother, sister. We're more than co-leaders. We're more than co-parents. We are lovers with a sexual dimension to our relationship. And so in standard, you know, sexuality, you know, sex is an activity. Let's go have sex, you know, and that's all the shows and TV, and that's what we do. But in Christian marriage, sex is a communication. It's something I say. I say, you are mine and I am yours. Honey, I want to be one with you. The culture just makes it, you know, it's just an activity. We just do, you can do sex with anybody. We're not animals, we're people, we're male and female. And so for us, just like when you hold hands, your spouse, you're saying something. When you put your arm around your spouse, you're saying something. When you kiss them, you're saying something. It's all, these are all communications. Okay, when we make love, when we enter into nakedness together, that we're communicating something. So we say to you, what do I want to say to you tonight? What do you want to say to me tonight? You know, it might be, I am yours, you are mine, I want to be close to you, I want to be in you, I want you to be in me, but it's a communication. That's what's so tragic about people just, you know, having sex, our young people are also confused. In standard marital spirituality, sex is secondary. You basically do it after you get everything done. Work and chores, checkbook, and kids, and basically it's just like, generally, there's very little left over. In Christian sexuality, sex is primary. It's primary. It's something you plan. It's something you think about. It's something you strategize. It's very conscious. We work on it. We talk about it. We create a life where we can have a sexual relationship. It's very, very difficult to have a sexual relationship and be married in the United States of America today. We have the most sexualized culture with married couples not having sex. I don't know if you're aware of that. Incredible. It's like huge. And 8% of couples are stuck sexually because no one talks about it. And it's just, there's stuff like this. It's just a matter of, it's something we got to grow in and learn in, and it's a process, but it's meant to be primary. And I know there's lots of problems, I'm sure, in this, you know, lots of problems. And I don't, what about this? We're stuck here, we're stuck there, but it's meant to be primary. So we don't give up on it. We work on it like part of this, it's part of our discipleship. Our marriage is part of our discipleship. Now, what's sad is I never got discipled in being married. I mean, it was kind of assumed it's going to work out. That is an illusion. It's not just going to work out. We will reproduce our parents' marriage. That's really scary. Unless someone intervenes and we get mentored and discipled on how to be married as Christians. That's a discipleship issue. Thirdly, sex is disconnected from our spirituality. It's just disconnected. I'm a Christian, I have sex, but it's kind of like, you know, they're not connected. But in Christian sexuality, sex is deeply connected to your spirituality. And so that oneness of nakedness without shame, of intercourse, is tightly related to my oneness and nakedness with Jesus each day. So it's deeply connected to my spirituality. It's not disconnected. Fourthly, sex is intercourse. In standard Christianity, you know, sex is intercourse. But in marital sexuality, it's more than intercourse. Sex is lovemaking all day long. I want to make love with my wife. Well, you know, I texted her, you know, before our meeting. know. I try to drive not like a maniac, you know. I call it lovemaking driving, you know. But it's this idea that we're making love not simply in the bedroom, but it's lovemaking all day long. And it's more than simply intercourse. It's much bigger than that. But, you know, intercourse obviously is involved and sexuality like that. And finally, sex is best when spontaneous is standard. Like, we got to both be in a mood, and it's got to be the right atmosphere, the right temperature, the right everything. You know, it's spontaneous. No, marital sexuality, sex is very planned and intentional because it's that central. It's part of our theology. That we are one. We're one flesh. We made a vow to be one flesh. We're to be a sign and wonder to the world. Jerry and I will often say to each other, let's go make love and save the world. You know, let's go make love and serve the church. Because we see it as part of our evangelism. We see it as part of our leadership. We see it as integrated into our spirituality. It's not compartmentalized. It's all one. So I'm going to close with two core practices I want to invite you to as couples, all right? Now, this is what we recommend to every couple in our church. Now, you have core practices as in your spiritual life, right? You have maybe quiet time in the morning, right? And time in the scripture and prayer, and you go to worship, you're tithing and giving. We have a number of core practices as followers of Christ. We all do. And that's good. And we need those, right? The purpose of those core spiritual practices is they're kind of like guardrails so we can meet God, right, along the way. And they keep us on track. And we all need those. Now, in the same way, if you're married here and you've made a vow to make marriage your first ambition, you made a vow to make this your first passion and pray for, you made a vow to be a sign and wonder of the world, then you need certain practices that keep you as guardrails on track with this. And so here's two. The two core ones, there's some others, but the two core ones that we recommend to every couple in our church, and we practice it. The first is this, that you pray for passion. You pray for that in-loveness, that romance, that craziness that you have for each other. You pray for it every day. Now, how many of you believe God answers prayer? Right? Yes. He will answer that prayer. Pray for passion for your spouse, that you'll be crazy about them. Pray it every day. You watch what happens. Pray you have sexual desire for them. You'll want them. Can't stop thinking about them. That's number one. And secondly is then we call something called skin to skin. And that is that every day, now you may miss days because things happen, but that you will be in each other's arms. Not for the sake of intercourse, but you'll be skin to skin, naked. Genesis 2:24, right? They were naked and without shame. First married couple, because Jesus came to restore that for us. You know that, right? The cross brought all that down. And you'll have skin to skin, naked, without lovemaking, just to be skin to skin every day. I'll say it again. That every day, just like you'll plan your day to have quiet time and scripture and fellowship. And you say, when are we going to have our skin to skin today? You like that? You like that? Now, what's funny, Jerry and I learned this from a couple that has 10 children. They're in their late 60s now, and they've been doing this for 35 years. 35 years. And it's a life changer. Now, we missed it. I'm here. I'm very aware. I'm here. Like, no skin to skin the last two nights, all right? And we miss. Things happen. You know, we miss. You know, you're totally exhausted. But we think about it every day, and we hit it most nights. I mean, it's like quiet time for us. It's like this is a we made a vow to be naked without shame with each other. Do you understand? We're not. Jerry and I, we have so much in common. We're like, we have great friendship, but we're more than friends. We're lovers. We're one flesh. We're married. Do you understand? There's nothing like it on earth. And for that 20 minutes, you know, it's just, whatever happens after that's fine, you know, but we say that 20 minutes is like, it's just to be naked. We do affirmations, encouragements with each other. It's very difficult to sustain that, obviously. So many interruptions, right? A million things going on in life. But that this becomes a core practice, and you say, we're going to fight for this thing, and you will. And you'll have starts and stops and starts and stops. But when we finally got over a hump with this thing, it was, you know, a number of years ago, it just changed everything for us. So with that, let me invite Steve and Cynthia to come forward here. And, I was actually thinking about the next phase here, but I need three chairs up here too. We're going to teach an exercise to close the night. I need just three chairs here. And, that's great. Okay, well, you guys did come to we run a leaders conference once a year in New York. And we do a pre-conference for 60 couples. We limit it to 60 couples because we have coaches there. And like in the back of your handouts, you're invited to come this year. It's first come, first serve. It usually fills months before. Do you realize how little there is for leaders marriage in the church? There's so little available. We end up, this thing packs out like 4 months before the conference. It's such a demand. Steve and Cynthia came to the conference. We spent a whole day. I just gave you like a quick intro, you know, but they spent a day on this. I don't know if you guys, you have a microphone there for these guys? Why don't we get a mic for them? One of these mics. I want to do the community temperature reading here, but I don't, if you want to share for a second, how was it for you? You heard all this, what I just shared, in a larger form, but what's been the impact for you? How has it been?
We don't have any more children.
Do you want me to start?
I think the wife usually gives the best read on the marriage. So I'll let Cynthia go first.
Oh, thank you. Well, actually, it was life-changing. We had to do a workshop where we did something called, should I share a little bit? About incarnational listening, where you learn how to really listen to your spouse, where you read their body language. You're not to respond at all. You're just to hear their heart, read their body language, and just listen to them. And then repeat back to them what you heard them say. And that was powerful. I realized, man, I haven't really listened to Steve for years. I mean, I was so distracted. I'm easily distracted. A little ADD, I think. But just to be really present, you know. And we went to this right after we became empty nesters, actually. So it was perfect timing. And it was powerful. I would say go, and it will just do wonders for us. And it brought us to another level of vulnerability in our marriage. After 33 years, I think, I feel like we love each other more now. And a lot of it is because we went to this marriage encounter, really.
Tremendous tools that we brought home with us. Many tremendous tools. That same exercise was also powerful for me because in trying to express my emotions, my vocabulary of expressing my emotions was like maybe 5 or 6 words. And one of the sheets that was in the material that we were given was some key words to express your emotions, but then there was a list of other words underneath it. So I had that right on my lap, literally, while we were talking so that I could be more specific with what I was feeling. And then another key element to that was just tremendously powerful, I felt like, was that offered a coach for every couple that was there. And so we had this amazing woman that was coaching us, and really causing us to go deeper and to ask more questions. And it was so helpful, so helpful.
At one point, Steve started talking, and then she said to Steve, look at this list. Now use these feeling words. And Steve goes, oh. He didn't really use feeling words very much. But when he did, it was like something broke. And then with me as well, you know, so it was powerful.
And why don't you, now you heard the skin-to-skin thing. Have you tried it, and what's been the fruit? Yes.
Yes.
We are.
Hi, Mom. I think my mom's watching, so hi, Mom.
Hi, Mom.
You know, it's funny, but...
Cynthia's mom's sitting right there.
Yeah. You can imagine how mortified our children are when they hear us talk about it. So I don't know what page it is in the EH Leader book, because there's a chapter on this, and we mentioned it. And I had people come to me, page 67. I love page 67. I don't know what page it is. You know, like, and I'm like, oh, yeah. It's very funny. But part of what we're doing, we're trying to break this, like, this is normal. This is life. This is spirituality. This is, we need to lead this conversation in the church. Do you realize that? I mean, all of our young people are learning it in the streets because we're uncomfortable. Do you understand? So it starts with our marriages. It starts with us. Like singles need marriages that can talk about these things desperately. And we find that singles flock to our church because they want to be around great marriages. They want to see, they haven't seen great marriages. All they've seen is broken marriages. So who wants to get married? I'll just live together. And so we're providing a sign and wonder and a gift. And our churches, we need to restore this for the kingdom of God, for the sake of the future. So once again, how has it been, you know, for you guys?
I will say one thing about skin to skin, and this is very vulnerable, but Steve and I, we live are kind of on different schedules. I'm a morning person, he's a night person. I mean, you can't help it. That's just kind of the way we're made up. But when we started this skin to skin, I would go to bed. I'd have to go to bed early because I get up so early, and so I'm tired, and Steve... He kind of gets a second wind at night sometimes, and that's his alone time, you know. But I remember once we started skin to skin, we always went to bed at the same time. And I realized that I had been going to bed, you know, earlier because I was tired, and Steve would come to bed later after I was asleep. I realized I would wake up feeling this kind of empty, kind of abandonment, and I didn't even know it was there until we started skin to skin, and I'd wake up feeling so connected to Steve just because we had that time right before I went to sleep. Even if you came in, had skin to skin, and then he got up for a while, you know, it's still that oneness, it was amazing what it did for
yeah.
me.
And I would second that. You don't realize the disconnect that can be there because of just the busyness of life that comes. And then when you start practicing something like this, from my end too, I felt that connectedness just begin to grow again. It was just really powerful for us. Yeah. And sometimes during the skin to skin, we would practice the CTR, or we would just talk about the day, or talk about the next day, our thoughts or desires. But yeah.
And sometimes it's hard for me to stay awake for 20 minutes.
Sure. I understand.
Just being in his arms is so comforting, you know. And
so just so you know, like we'll ask people coming into church, couples, like, we call it homework. Like, did you do your homework? And we'll joke around the leaders, you can't serve if you've not done your homework. Like, you're out of order, like, go home. You know? But we have staff show up and say, you know, they show up, you know, come in the office at 10, say, yeah, we just finished our skin to skin, ready to start the day, you know. And we got a big evening today, but it's like part of the language of the leadership in our church. Like, this is what we do as married couples, and it's really wonderful. So I commend it to you. I really do. Jesus is first. Your marriage is second. And the church is third. I love the church. I've given my life for the church of Jesus Christ. But if you love the church of Jesus Christ, you put your marriage before it. And your church will be blessed. And the kingdom of God will grow. And you'll be a gift. But make no mistake about it. It's like a prophetic. It's like a prophetic. Something very prophetic. And our age needs prophetic couples. We need prophetic marriages more than ever. For our generation and the generation that's coming. All right, so thank you very much. Okay, stay here. Won't go. So if you have your notes, go back a page at the end of session two. I wonder if we should we do this community temperature reading? We'll just do it briefly. Should we do it?
Sure.
All right, so let me explain one of the, do we have a, 20 minutes? Can I have 15, 20 minutes? Can I do something before we close? Is that okay?
All right.
Okay, so I'm going to give you a very abbreviated skill. Remember I said there's Emotionally Healthy Relationships course, which is one of the courses we invite you to bring into your churches for discipleship. And there's 8 skills. The first skill of the Emotionally Healthy Relationship course is called the Community Temperature Reading. It's found there on page, bottom of page 9. It says Community Temperature Reading. See that? 11. Yeah, it starts on page 9. Yes, yes. And you see on the bottom page it says, the purpose is to increase awareness within yourself of your God-given value and to build healthy relationships with others. So again, marriage is not just a physical connection, obviously, sexual connection. It's an emotional connection. So we've got to grow in our emotional oneness, spiritual oneness, emotional oneness, physical oneness, relational oneness in every sense of the word. And so in a church, we're teaching people to love well, to bond. And so again, if you didn't pick up that emotional skills 2.0 curriculum, you want to get that. There's only a few copies out there, but this is in there with the other skills. You want to look at this stuff. I'm going to give you a very brief introduction because these are life-changing skills, not just for marriages, but for singles and everybody in the church. It's the way we function in body life. So there's 5 areas, and now starting on top of page 10. And basically, it's a way to go back and forth, and it's a way to improve healthy temperature of emotional connection for whether it's couples, singles, groups, church staffs, you name it. And so it starts with appreciations. I'm on the top of page 10. So begin with like appreciations. Joy about the positive aspects of life together, you know, what's good. Most of the time we don't appreciate people unless they go over and beyond the call of duty. Then we might say something. And we generally appreciate people based on how our families did. If you didn't get a lot of appreciations growing up, it's probably difficult for you to do it now as an adult. And so we very intentionally express appreciations here in the body of Christ. That's why giving thanks to God and giving praise to God in Psalms are closely connected. But we want to teach, we're wired to my wife calls it brain food, you know, being appreciated. It does something to your brain, it lights it up. So, you know, I really appreciate Dan inviting me here and Steve, and I appreciate your warmth. I really appreciate the service tonight, and it was just beautifully done. It was elegant, and I appreciate all you folks who got ordained. I appreciate being here. I appreciate so many things here, you know, about being here in these couple days. Yeah, I appreciate, honey, you filled the car up with gas. I appreciate, Jerry, you spent time with our daughter Maria while I was gone. You know, appreciations. Number 2. Oh, let me go on. So there we go. Community temperature reading. Number 1, it starts with appreciation, or it can just be, I'm excited about things. So it's actually intentionally expressing an appreciation. Number 2, we call it worries, concerns, or puzzles. Obviously, worries or concerns are easy. Puzzles is the key word. I want you to, this word will change a culture, change relationships. Most of us jump to judgmentalism, to negative interpretations when things happen. So for example, what do you do when you send an email to someone and they don't respond? What's the story you tell yourself? Bum. Selfish. They don't think I'm important. They must be hurt or offended by something I did. I mean, we tell ourselves all kinds of stories. Negative, we just jump to negative interpretations. Then we send them another email and they still don't respond. Or we call them, they don't call us back. And we do all these negative interpretations. And so this word puzzle is a very powerful word to not jump to assumptions. They help us pause and they catch us. Jerry likes to say she sins 50% less because of the word puzzle. So for example, instead of saying, okay, I sent Dan an email, really important email, he never responds. I sent him another one, we're on the same staff team, for example, he doesn't respond. What do I do? Now, first I'm mad at him, because I've jumped to interpretations about it. So instead I say, okay, instead of, you know, going after, why didn't you return my email? You know, I say, Dan, I'm puzzled. You know, I sent you two emails, and I never heard from you. So I really don't know why he didn't. I have no idea why he didn't respond. Maybe he never got it. Maybe it went to spam. Maybe he's been really busy. Maybe he just read it and skipped over it real quick because he got so many emails. Well, I have no idea. So I just say, I'm puzzled. You know, has anybody ever said to you, that sermon stunk? They said it to me. I won't even say the word they used. And your first reaction is, oh, really? You go find yourself another church, you idiot. You know, get out of here. You know? I poured my life out in that sermon. You say, Pastor, that sermon, I'll use the word stunk. And now, a puzzle, I'm really puzzled. What was it about the sermon that was so bad for you? Could just be something very simple. You know what? I'm exhausted. I didn't sleep all night. Or you know what? You mentioned something politically that really pissed me off. You know, and I thought you were saying this. And, you know, I don't know yet. So I'm puzzled. You know, I walk in the door instead of saying, you should have paid that bill, honey, I thought you're supposed to be paying the bills, you know, I'm puzzled that you haven't paid that bill yet. I'm puzzled. I don't know what happened. So it's a great word. It's worth $1 million. It'll change your church, actually, if you actually learn it. Okay, third, complaints and recommendations. Now, I don't know how your family did complaining, but we teach people how to do complaints in the new family of Jesus. We do it differently. So we actually give them a phrase as a training wheel to get started. I notice and I prefer. So, you know, my wife and I have this running, you know, I pay the bills in our house, so I'm always lowering the thermostat. Always lowering. And she's always raising it. And instead of saying, what's the problem? Are you paying the bills here, right? You know, honey, you know, she'll say to me, I notice, Pete, that you lower the thermostat. And I would prefer that you talk with me before you do. All right? Our daughters are over our house a lot, you know, and they do dishes and they just whatever, make a mess. And, you know, I notice you left the dishes in the sink and plates on the table. You know, and I prefer that if you're going to come over here and, you know, make yourself a meal, that I prefer if you would actually put the dishes in the dishwasher. Instead of saying, what's the problem with you? You're 21. You know, am I going to be your mama and forever, you know? And so I notice and I prefer. Very powerful. Someone shows up late, you know, for a meeting. You know, what happened? Again, you know, I notice. You say, I'm puzzled. I'm puzzled you're late. Or, you know, I notice that you show up 10 minutes late. You know, I prefer that we start the meeting, you know, on time. Or I notice we start the meeting on time. I prefer we start 10 minutes late because I know people are hitting traffic, in New York especially. So again, we're going to use this for, this is a basic skill. This is a simple introductory skill. So this is for light annoyances. This is not like heavy things like my sex life, your sex life, you know, heavy things. That's not the skill for heavy complaints. This is light stuff, okay? Got that? I don't want battles going on here. Next, new information. So again, healthy relationships, just new information, you know. You know, we got invited to a party, you know, next Friday night. Or, hey, you know what? Carmen's still in the hospital. You might want to go visit her. So, you know what? My meeting was canceled. Just information, what's going on. I'm hoping to go to get a master's someday, you know, at Life Pacific. Just what's going on. But we share things. It's part of healthy relationships. We're getting information out. And then finally, hopes and wishes. And there's so much I can say about this. But, you know, hopes, when people share hopes and wishes, you get a window into their soul, whether it's little things or big things. It could be something as simple as, you know, I hope to get that new job, or, you know, I really hope our church is able to make a good hire this year, you know, in the area of small groups and evangelism, or, you know, I really hope that we can get on vacation to Colorado, or, you know, I mean, because something is, I really hope to have a Sabbath, you know, this week, you know, by going camping, you know, with a friend. You know, it can be anything simple, something that gives us a glimpse into who you are, and sharing hopes and wishes, it just keeps relationships alive. Now, there's a lot of theory behind all this. But it's a nice way to basically create community, whether it's a community of two in a marriage, a community of friends, community of a small group or a staff team or all that. So let's just have, well, you two, you're going to demonstrate it, okay? So why don't you get it in, I'll be your coach. So why don't you, got to face each other. And they're going to do it. And so as you'll look at on the bottom of the page there, you'll see the, I'll sit right here. Why don't you go in the center there? And get knee to knee, get close enough, you know. And so, is this live?
Yeah.
Oh, it's live. Okay, good. That's even better. All right.
And we haven't discussed this.
You haven't discussed this. Good, good. All right, good. So, again, so you want to ask, can we do a community temp? Or we call it CTR for short. You know, can we do a CTR? You know, just a kind of a catch-up, you know?
So, honey, are you okay if we do a CTR right now?
Sure.
Okay, great.
I think.
So, would you like to get? Would you like to
so
go first?
Start with appreciations. Okay. You just mention each category so they can follow. Okay. We're going to go up that temperature reading together.
Let me start.
Would you like to?
Sure. I appreciate that since we've had a grandchild in our room the last couple of days, we've been woken up a lot, but you woke up in the morning very cheerful and very happy, and I know that was a choice because there's one night where we woke up every 2 hours. So I appreciate that about you, that you chose to be cheerful and happy even when you didn't get enough sleep.
Well, I'm very appreciative of just the opportunity that we can have with having Hannah and our grandson with us. And I really appreciate all the people that came over while we were standing over there for your ordination service to come and pray with you and to just love on you and hug on you. I just really appreciate all those people that did that.
The next category is puzzles, worries, concerns. I'm puzzled why you left the car parked out in front of the hotel.
Very good.
All day. You don't have to explain.
It was only for 36 hours. So
awesome. Excellent. Thank you.
I'm beginning to worry that I forget things like that. And I do have worries for some of our children and the life that it looks like their life is headed, and it just concerns me, and I'm worried about that. The next category is complaints and possible solutions.
Well, one complaint I had is that when
the service... I prefer.
Oh, I prefer...
No, I notice.
I noticed. I'll get this right. I noticed that when the service started, I was standing there alone.
Good.
Thinking, where's my husband? And I would prefer... especially sent for the ordination service, that you would have been there. And
good. Excellent.
Awesome. Great job. I hear that. You can say it. It's good. Yeah. I hear that. Thank you. I really don't, at this time, I really don't have anything on my mind or heart that I would have as a complaint or anything that I'd notice that I'd like to bring to attention, okay. Anything like that.
Good. Great. All right, new information.
New information?
I can't think of any new information at this time.
I'm going to be greeting at church this Sunday, so I'll need to be there about 30 minutes earlier than normal. Hopes and wishes.
I have big hopes with the ordination service today and what's ahead for our life in ministry together, even.
Yeah, that's awesome. And I would just agree with that. I feel like my hopes have just been refreshed for our life together and the things that will flow out of our marriage. I also have a hope that coaching opportunities will just continue to increase, because it's just something I love and is very dear to my heart. Yeah.
Awesome.
Thank you. Let's give them a hand.
Thank you very much.
All right. Just out of curiosity, how often do you guys do that CTR together as a couple?
Oh, we try to do it at least twice a week.
Oh, yeah. Okay, good. Yeah. That's great. Okay, it's we call it confiding light tool. All right. And okay, so just I want to make a couple observations, and I'm going to have you do it. Did you notice they were you know, eye to eye? Again, many of us grew up in homes that we weren't eye to eye. We're talking, someone's doing dishes, someone's over there, we're having a conversation all the time. And you'll notice, as a couple, they're actually, you know, knee to knee, they're close to each other, they're present. Did you notice they didn't answer, like the 36-hour parking in front of the hotel? Not only did he didn't get a ticket, thank God, you know, and all that. But, you know, he could have responded and said, yeah, you know, I mean, you did mention about being distracted or something, you know, how that happened. But yeah, he could have said, yeah, I really lost it. And but he wasn't defensive. Jay said, yeah, you know, it was very respectful. I noticed that you didn't move the car for 36 hours in front of the hotel. And you notice you can skip one. They actually skipped, like you didn't have a complaint. Okay? And she did. So that's fine. I'm going to ask you. I'm going to ask that actually when you do this, because you may not be with your spouse, you may have them stand in for somebody. So you say, listen, you're going to stand in for, you know, Dan, you know, or somebody else, or somebody, a coworker, or your supervisor, or a boss, or your mom, or mother-in-law, or a friend, and just say, we just stand, I want to practice it. I notice, you know, at work, you give me work at 5 o'clock, right before I'm walking out the door, you put a load of work on me, and I end up leaving at 7 o'clock. And I'd really appreciate if you would give me that work at 3 o'clock, and not at the last minute at 5 o'clock. Okay, so say, just to practice it, because again, depending on your family of origin and your culture, different ones of these are going to be very difficult. If you've never made a complaint in a respectful way before, believe me, I notice and I prefer it's very difficult to say. Or if you came from a family that never did appreciations, believe me, it is hard to show an appreciation because you're just not used to it. Same thing with hope and wishes. If you never had a voice to actually share, what do I hope? What do I long for? It's hard. We had one person, she just started weeping. I'm like, it was like a light, this was a light exercise, she's weeping. And what happened? And she was a PhD student. And she said, she was actually Korean-American and very brilliant, but she said, no one ever has asked me what are my hopes and wishes. And I'm 31 years old, and I'm in a field that I hate because I've never had a voice to share what I want in life. And for the first time, there's a group of people actually asked me, what do I hope for? And our whole life actually got, over time, just got so transformed. Okay, so what you're going to do is you're going to now get in groups of two, just two. You and your specific spouse, obviously with your spouse. If you're not with a friend, if you know somebody you're with, if you're not with somebody you know, it's fine. I mean, strangers, you know, couple people do is introduce yourself, and you're going to actually do it. You go up. You're gonna go up the. Oops. Oh, I'm sorry. Here's the guidelines. Face each other, look at each other in the eye. Take turn. You'll take turns back and forth. You see that? They went back and forth up that thing. Keep sharing light, and it's very brief. This is not a long thing. Use only sentence stems that are given. Do not interrupt or respond. Just listen. So here it is. There's that community temperature reading. You're gonna go up that temperature thing. All right. Starting with appreciation is going up. So just turn to someone or find a partner. If you need to be a group of three, be a group of three. And get together. Thank you. So we got two microphones. We have one there. And we have one here. So just raise your hands, if you could. Right there. And if you could speak in the mic, that'd be great.
So, of course, I was nervous at first because I was talking to a stranger. That was the first thing, but I just think the questions, they're really, really good. That's all right. It was just the nervousness in the beginning.
Sure, absolutely.
That was really good, but I think it's good because I think it creates relationship.
Yep.
And I think that's the biggest thing about it, because it helps you get to know a person just in that little time.
Absolutely.
Of kind of like what's important and what's good. So I thought it was awesome.
Excellent. And just so you know, we're very aware that we're teaching people how to function and how to be in community in the new family of Jesus. They're very aware theologically. They come out of families of origin. They did appreciations. Maybe they did complaints. I mean, how many of your families did healthy complaining? That was respectful. Well, we're going to teach you how to do it here in the new family of Jesus. How many of your family did puzzles, or did they jump to sarcasm and judgmentalism? Boom, boom. And so it's in your bones. You just jump to judgment. And now in the new family of Jesus, we don't judge people so quickly. We use a nice word called puzzle. All right? Okay, now others. What was that experience like for you? Yes, right here.
Well, what I notice about myself is a lot of times that we can't be real truthful. Or we can be, but I always wait for the opportunity until I'm irritated, and I can be very cutting in all situations. And when you do that, you're asking permission.
Yes.
Tell me the truth.
So are you referring to when you said, I notice and I prefer, that you did it over something, you did it better this time?
Well, I just think it's engaging.
It is.
We're giving each other permission.
Yes.
Good. Speak into my life.
Excellent. It's creating a structure of equal power, actually. You know, because usually, and especially in relationships, sometimes some person is exercising more power and takes up more space than the other. And what this does is actually even out power. It helps introverts also to get an opportunity to speak. Because often we extroverts, we just dominate talking all the time. Okay, others, what was that experience like for you? Yes.
Well, in response to him, okay. It was exposing to look at him in the eye. Because it's much easier for me in confronting him with a complaint for me to be doing the dishes with my back to him so I don't see the expression on his face.
Yes.
So to look at him in the eye and say, I notice that and I prefer, is very exposing of my tender heart towards him.
Very good. Wonderful. And you did it.
Yeah.
Congratulations. That's awesome. That's excellent. And my wife and I, our first 7-8 years of our marriage, we had machine gun conversation. I can finish your sentence for you. So why wait? You know, and we basically would not look at each other in the eye. We especially went in difficult conversations. So, yes, excellent. Anybody else? Yes.
So, yeah. So Crystal's noticing things right now as we are sitting here, which is awesome. That she notices
right
and prefers a lot of things. But I think, yes. She noticed I took the microphone. She preferred I did not. That was
absolutely
something that happened just now.
Yes.
But I think for me having notice and prefer, because I'm like I don't shy away from confrontation honestly with other people, but I shy away from confrontation with her because I don't want to hurt her feelings. I don't want to, you know. And so I wait until something really pisses me off, and then I'm like, okay, we're going to talk about this right now.
Yeah.
And I think having that, you know, I notice, I prefer, you know, it was like it was almost like I noticed, like I said something, and then like. Or she complained about something in that way, and like we laughed about it. I was like, okay, yes, I do need to fix that, or I do need, you know, like, and it was very light. It was a lot more lighthearted than
yes.
What you would expect it to be if you just kind of wait and wait and wait until it's just like, okay, you know, we need to have this conversation. We need to have it now. So I thought that was really, really good.
That's excellent. Great. That's great. All right, anybody else? Right here. Ah, okay. Please stand. I'll just stand.
I notice that Sal has to stand up, and I prefer that he doesn't have to. No, I really liked the eye-to-eye contact, because we have four kids, and we're church planters, and we have two businesses, and 12 people living in our house right now. So to be able to have a moment where you're actually able to, like, look at somebody in the eye and have a conversation with them is very few and far between. So it was very nice. And even, like, when we were talking, my phone was texting, my 13-year-old daughter is texting me, and everybody, and I was like, I was very tempted to look at the text message, but then I put it away because we were connecting eye to eye.
That's wonderful.
It was good.
That's great. And so, you know, again, just I'll just make that marriage application, but obviously, do you understand, you got a lot going on. But I want you to, but your marriage is first. So somehow you got to construct time for emotional connection, physical connection, that's the highest priority of your life in the midst of church planting. That's a challenge. So you've really got to sit down and think about that. So, all right, so let me close with a couple comments, and we'll go to our reception. So this is a very elastic tool. Now, this is a training wheel. Think of a bicycle. We're basically putting a training wheel on you so you can ride that bike. And it's kind of a little bit of a straitjacket, you know? But it's a straitjacket to get you moving, to be able to bond in a healthy way. That's what this is about in the new family of Jesus. And now, good. It comes a place where. So you might say to your spouse, "Let's do a CTR, community temperature. Can we do a CTR? It takes less than 10 minutes. We do a CTR. It's just a quick catch up on a number of areas that kind of stretches from hopes to complaints, and so it's a very nice tool to have. And we did it. You can do it as a couple. We did it in our family for years, at the table, dinner table. Let's do a CTR, everybody. Kids love complaints. Love it. Love it. Love it. I noticed, you know, and again, like everything can, every tool, this is a tool, every tool can be used to build or it can be used to beat up and tear down. So, you know, I'm puzzled, you know, well, obviously you're not using the tool properly, okay? Now you're using it as a weapon to hurt somebody. And, it's a very elastic tool. You can use it at a table with 5, 6, 7 people. And it takes a little bit longer, obviously. You're not going to do over ones. Anybody have any appreciations right now? Oh, yeah, I appreciate. We do it at our staff meeting at church. Our staff meeting, every week, we do appreciations. And we do about 10 minutes. Like 25 of us in a room. And I really appreciate, Joe, the way that you came through with the sound system last week. We had an electrical problem, and you went back there and you fixed it. I want to really thank you. I really appreciate, George, the way you're taking care of the building. And the way that room looks awesome. You know, I really appreciate Rich. You preached a great sermon on Sunday. You know, I really appreciate Rosie, the way you're doing children. I mean, it's just beautiful. Creates a great culture. And that's the only one we do most weeks. We start our meetings with that. I've had people do internships with us who come out of the corporate world. And we say, what's the highlight of the internship? And they said, staff meetings. I never experienced healthy team before. And very often it was appreciations because it just creates a culture. And it can be used as small groups use it. You could use it at a restaurant. Singles use it all the time in different settings. We use it at singles events. Youth use it. We always say, like, if you're tight on time, you can skip certain ones. Let's just do appreciations and hopes and wishes. If you know there's tension in the room, you can just say, you know what? We're going to do, you know, the first three, we're going to skip complaints. Say you know there's tension in the room. You just say, we're going to skip complaints. They don't know you know why you're skipping it, because you don't want to have that time. You don't have enough safety right now to do it. There's some intense complaints that have to be dealt with somewhere else. And so it's an elastic tool. You can pick and choose it as you see fit. But what's really beautiful is, see, the goal of these skills is to transform the church culture as a new family of Jesus, that we're actually a loving community that's different than the culture out there, and it's safe. And so, and then they bring it to the workplace. That's really the goal. This is actually, you're bringing it to the, your people, all my workplace, I work for the school, the Board of Education in New York, they're gossipy, they're backbiting. We have police officers, a whole bunch of, I mean, the New York Police Department is just a brutal place to work, I mean, the system itself. And, but we say, no, that's why you're there. You're sent into that police department to actually build community where there's chaos, or into the school system. And so we have people doing this in their offices, workplaces, schools as teachers, youth in groups. I mean, it's amazing. It becomes actually a tool that we go out there and build community where there's chaos, our people. And so, again, the goal is not using the tool. It actually gets so in you, you don't need the training wheels anymore. So, for example, Jerry, whose family is, she's not here right now, is very judgmental, okay? And so it was, believe me, my wife has a tongue on her initially, boy. But she's a different person. So she can be at the supermarket, and you're ever there, and like there's only two lines open, there's like nine cashiers, nobody's there. And like in the past, she'd be quite angry and make a comment, all right? But now she'll go to that desk of customer service and says, she'll say, I'm puzzled. There's two cashiers there, and there's a line, you know, 15, 20 people each, and there's nine that are empty. Would it be possible to get some other employees to get those fill those cashiers up so we can get through the line? I'm like, sure, thank you. I mean, and she used the word puzzle. And but it's just it catches her. So if someone in our church says, you know, it happened just recently, an intern, our new staff guy, and he was annoyed. You know, worship isn't our worship went too long on Sunday. You know, it really cut into, you know, time for whatever the sermon and the flow of the service. And it was a Bama complaint. And you know, right there he got stopped. We don't make complaints like that here at New Life Fellowship Church. So if you ever, it's good that you said you noticed something that really bothered you, but you always have to make a recommendation for a change. What do you prefer? Anybody can be irresponsible, make a complaint, that's easy. But what do you want to do differently? So every time people are, in a sense, functioning in an immature way, which is a lot in our churches, these are discipleship moments. Like Jesus and the 12 along the way. You say, you know what? Andrew, we don't do dirty fighting here. That's a different skill. And it's a moment to talk about it and reinforce it, because people are not going to get it just practicing it once. There's no way. That's why we as leadership got to own these skills. And then we naturally bring it. So we start with our marriages. So you'll be surprised at how many people don't talk eye to eye. They don't know how to have a conversation with anybody eye to eye, except their cat, you know, or their dog. Seriously. And so we want to grow our people up. So, you know, help them actually to do what the Bible says and love well. So I commend this to you. May I encourage you to this week to practice this community temperature reading three times. Just try it for 1 week. Just try it. And with your spouse or with a good friend, if you're single, and just watch what happens and see if you can incorporate it into your life. Okay? Thank you. That's it. God bless you, everybody. Great to be with you.